Welcome, friends. Today's session is about transactional analysis. The term appears very complicated, isn't it? However, as teachers, we are constantly making multiple transactions. Whether you are in the classroom, whether you are in the teacher's room, whether you are talking to your, you know, peers, you are talking to your superiors, you are constantly making transactions. These transactions that we make are actually part of our profession, part of our personal life. The most important part today then is to discuss how can we make these transactions more effective? Are we able to really convey what we want to convey? Or are there certain things within us, in our past, in our experience, that we are, you know, without our knowledge, involuntarily bringing it to the classroom or to our transactions? Before we get deeper into what really transactional analysis is, let's ask a couple of questions. Go back to your classrooms, think of your classrooms, and think of this particular occasion where maybe you have this extremely difficult student, a student who does not listen to you, a student who is constantly distracting you. And how many times have you actually lost your temper? Have you done that? I have done that. And I have found it very difficult. When I come out of it and when I go back to my own room or when I go back to some time for myself, I feel that I should have done differently. I should have interacted differently. Maybe I shouldn't have scolded my student. Maybe I should have actually tried to understand what is the reason behind his behavior. Why is this particular student behaving the way he or she is behaving? Haven't you gone through this feeling? Well, today let's discuss things like this, behaviors like this, incidents like this, that make our life a little difficult. And if it is making our life difficult, is there a way to deal with it? Of course there is, and therefore we are going to talk about transactional analysis. So to start with, if you look at the slide in front of you, you will see that I have called it a teacher's introduction. Because transactional analysis is a concept, is a theory and a practice that can be used in various aspects of life, in various arenas of our life. But today we are going to focus only how we can use it as teachers in a classroom, in our self-introspection and understanding ourselves. So let us look at the various topics that I'm going to bring in. But before that, let's look at the person who started this whole concept called transactional analysis. In fact, Eric Byrne, way back, you know, he started way back in the mid-60s, in fact, even mid-50s, he was a follower of the Freudian psychology. All of us have heard of Sigmund Freud, and I need not really go deep into that. However, Byrne found a difficulty there. What he found difficult is that Freud's psychology brings in regression, and it becomes a little difficult for him to close the loop. So what is it that he started? He started saying that every transaction that we make in our social interaction is open to analysis. And why is it open to analysis, or how is it open to analysis? Because each transaction brings in the person who is communicating, the person who is receiving, and the transaction that happens between the two of them or multiple people. At times, what happens is these transactions are not always what it appears to be on the surface. So if I am telling somebody, well, how are you today? I may or may not be presenting this straight as the sentence lexically means. That is the meaning, the semantics of the sentence. There may be other aspects underlying this sentence. And these transactions, social transactions, have very interestingly a stimulus. And this stimulus has a response. So for example, if let us say two people meet each other, and when they meet each other, they spend some time together. However hard they try to keep quiet, whether it is verbally or non-verbally, they will communicate. They will say something to each other. That means there will be stimulus from one person, and what will come from the other side is a response. Right? Now, if this is happening, and this is happening at various levels of complexity in our various transactions, how do I deal with these transactions? What exactly can I analyze about these transactions? Basically, that's what transactional analysis is, to put it very simply. So let's look at, even before we continue from here, let's look at the topics that we are going to discuss today. So we're going to explore the psychology of human transactions. I am not going to deal with animal transactions, that's not the topic for today, but human transactions, and especially human transactions in the classroom vis-a-vis the teacher and the students. So we will discuss a couple of theories. We will also look at how these theories can be applied to our classrooms. We will look at what really is transactional analysis. We will look at it as many of us say, what is it for me? Why am I going to listen to transactional analysis? As it is, I'm pretty burdened with all kinds of theory. I have a whole set of brats or students who really are troubled for me. But is there anything that I can gain from this? Yes, definitely. As a teacher, you and I learn a lot from transactional analysis, which we can bring to the classroom. The various aspects of transactional analysis that we are going to discuss, we are going to discuss ego states and how to use it. We are going to talk about a hunger theory. We will be discussing strokes and stroke economy. We will look at life positions and their impact on our behavior. And when I say our behavior, I also refer to our students' behavior. Of course, we all play different kinds of games in our various transactions. And so we will be talking about games people play. And finally, we will be discussing why is TA required in education? Is it possible to make use of TA in education? And how am I going to use TA in the classroom? Let's start with the basics of transactional analysis. Very simply, as I was discussing in the introduction, any transaction is nothing but a unit of social intercourse or a unit of social interaction, right? And what happens, as I said, when there are two or more people, you know, encounter each other, after a point of time or sooner or later, these two people will be acknowledging each other's presence in some way or the other. When we acknowledge each other's presence, this is called a transactional stimulus. When I acknowledge your presence, you will, with some effort, even if you don't want, voluntarily or involuntarily respond to me. You may say that I don't respond, I choose to be silent. Well, that itself is a response. So everything that happens in a transaction is nothing but a transactional stimulus followed by a transactional response. The analysis of this stimulus and response and what happens behind the scenes that leads to, that triggers the stimulus and response is transactional analysis. So, what really is transactional analysis? The basics, the thought behind it is that life is a process of dynamic urges and counterchecks. We make certain urges. And these urges come from within. Sometimes they come involuntarily, they come from our subconscious. And when they come from our subconscious, we may or may not be aware why we have done so. It happens that as you are walking down the street, at times you may, you know, kind of wriggle up your nose and, you know, make a face because you have seen something visually or felt something, you know, olfactorily. You may not realize that you are actually creating or making that expression. It's a dynamic urge from within. And when you go back and analyze, you will realize that it is a result of multiple triggers way back from your past. It could be from your early childhood stages. And when we realize this, we countercheck ourselves. And we say, did I do this? If I did it, why did I do it? Am I alert to that? So transactional analysis is based on this as the first thought. The second is, we all have stored memories or tapes. What happens? Typically, like it happens in a computer. Or for example, in today's times, we Google, right? And if we Google, the moment we key in the first word, if we have keyed in the same sentence or the same stimulus earlier, it will immediately pop up as our past responses. That means Google or any of these softwares, they have a stored memory. It's nothing new. It's something that they have taken from human behavior. As human beings, we have stored memories or tapes. And the moment we get a familiar stimulus or certain stimuli, we bring out these memories and respond to those stimuli. And finally, therefore, the core principle that we are working with is social transaction, and therefore transactional analysis. So let's therefore look at what kinds of transactions, how we respond to these transactions, and how can we analyze them. Definitely, as I said from the very beginning, we are looking at human behavior, isn't it? All of you are humans and interacting with other people. So it's your own behavior and your students' behavior that we are going to analyze. But there are, of course, certain methodology that we follow. There's a different four methods that Eric Byrne has brought out. We can do a structural analysis of a transaction. We can do a transactional analysis. We can do game analysis. And also we can do script analysis. What really is this transactional analysis? If you look at the slide in front of you, it basically says that I can understand and identify my own ego states and the one that I am using in a transaction. We'll come to ego states and discuss at length very soon. What happens in a transactional analysis? We will again be understanding and identifying the ego states, but that will be based on the interaction that happens between two people or more people. What happens? What is game analysis? How many times have you played similar games? Go back to your childhood. You wanted a new vehicle. You wanted a new, let's say, a laptop. Or you wanted a particular game. So what do? I have done this earlier. I would actually walk up to my parents and put up a very sad face and a serious face. And then I, talk about how my friends or my peers have this gadget. And I do not have it, be it a latest, smartphone or a laptop or, way back, any ordinary object that I wanted, a new notebook or a particular kind of pen, whatever it is. Now, what do? We play a game over there. And the game is that I actually say, okay, so many people have it. I don't have it. That's all right if I don't have it. But I would have loved it if I had it. So what am I doing? I'm actually playing a game. I am playing to the emotions of my parents over there. So we will be looking at game analysis and games that we play in a classroom, games our students play in the classroom. And therefore, we will be looking at these transactions, understanding these transactions, and how that leads to bad feelings. Let me give you a very quick analysis. All of you must have watched advertisements, right? What happens in an advertisement? If you look at it, the advertisement starts talking about a difficult situation. Okay, however simple it is. For example, I don't have a washing machine. I am, washing clothes with my hands and I'm extremely tired. I find it very difficult. I can't do the fun things in life. And then suddenly, boom, there comes the washing machine, straight from heaven. And my life changes totally. Does life really change? No. But that's the game that the advertisers are playing with you. What they are doing is they are creating a lacuna, a sense of disadvantage, a sense of not having what I want. Okay? And once that game is played and you are hooked, they sell the product to you. The same happens in human interactions, human transactions also. And finally, we will also look at a script analysis. All of us as individuals live a script. Just like it happens in the theater, it happens in a play, it happens with us also. And where do we build these scripts? How are the scripts written? They are written from the day, from the time we are in our mother's womb. The behavior, the experiences a mother feels, goes through, the social interactions, the psychological trauma or the psychological, experiences that the mother feels impacts the child from that point, and our script starts building from then. And as we are, the moment we are born, the kind of warmth we get, the kind of, you know, response we get from people around us, be it our mother or other adults, the kind of relationship we have with our siblings, the kind of messages that people have sent to us, telling us what is right, what is wrong, helps us to build our script. And therefore, we need to understand what is the script that we have and how this script has helped us or, you know, forced us to create a life plan for us. So these are the various methods that we use to understand human behavior in transactional analysis. All right, so next is the crucial question. What's in it for the teacher? I explained to all of you, or, you know, introduced to all of you the various topics or the various themes that we are going to explore in this session. The most critical question then is, what's in it for me? Is there something that I really am going to take back if I listen to this session? Yes, there is a lot that we can take back as teachers, and let me start from there. All of you would have heard this very, very common saying, charity begins at home. I extend it further and I say that I can, you know, share, I can be, empathetic, I can love others if I can love myself. I can take care of others if I can take care of myself, because the practice happens with me. If I don't love myself, I really hate myself, then it is very difficult for me to show love to others. And as teachers, we need to keep in mind that our students spend a large amount of the whole 24 hours with us. And it's not our job just to give them subject knowledge. In today's world, if you have a relatively smart student, the student doesn't need us anymore, because there's an information overload all around us. Hence, what is it that the teacher brings to the class? The teacher brings to the class the human element. And this human element is made up of various aspects. This is not a robo, right? You and I are not robots. We are human beings. We come with our past experiences. We come with chips on our shoulders. We come with a huge baggage. At the same time, we also come with the human touch. But many of us, because we are continuously doing the same thing again and again, meeting the same people again and again, we have become pretty jaded. We have forgotten to understand ourselves. And therefore, we don't even make an effort to understand our students. The only thing that we do in a classroom, and I have done that, I am, you know, kind of, I would say that a culprit in this area at times, that I bring in my that 50 minutes or 1 hour's content with me, I dole it out to my students, and then I leave the classroom. Without thinking, how has it impacted my students? Is there somebody in my classroom who has found this difficult, who has found it extremely, unpalatable, who has not really wanted to listen to me, or who has come from home that morning after being scolded by his parents? Have I thought of these aspects? Maybe not. But I know, and I, as an experiencer, as a student, have looked forward to my teachers to reach out to me individually, as an individual, as a human being, as a person. And therefore, I say that as a teacher, the journey is from the self to the student. Here, I want to give you a very quick example. You know, when I was doing my advanced studies, you know, one of my professors, excellent, you know, I really look up to him. But however, he would never make eye contact with us in the classroom. He would walk into the classroom and he would look down at the floor and walk straight to the, you know, blackboard and start teaching. However, we were all adults, we were post-postgraduate students, but still somewhere there was a niggling doubt that why doesn't he make any eye contact? Why doesn't he, you know, ask us questions in the classroom? Interestingly, after the first semester, and we had given our first assignment, he walked into the classroom with a pile of papers and with our assignments. And you know what he did? He walked up to the table where he usually used to stand, still not making eye contact, pulled out a paper, read out the name of the person and the roll number, and stretched his hand to the regular place where, you know, the student sits. For example, when he called out my name, he said, he just picked it out and said, Mridula Das. And he stretched his hand right to that seat where I used to sit every day. Interestingly, I was not sitting there that day. I was, you know, sitting in some other seat, and he looked up. What struck me was that the whole semester, he was aware of us. He knew each of us, where we sat, what responses we gave, and he tuned his lessons to that. Interesting, isn't it? However, I wish he had also made eye contact that whole semester and made us realize that. Therefore, what is in it for the teacher in this session? I need to understand I need to understand myself. That's the first. As I said, we interact with students every day. We handle their need for knowledge. We give them feedback on what they do, what they don't do. But do we really know who we are? What is this person that comes to the classroom? Why we say or do something the way we say it or do it? What are these drivers that are making us the way we are? You know, some of us are very stiff. Some of us are very stern. Some of us are very playful. Some of us are, you know, erudite. Why are we the way we are? This is what we are going to really bring here. And with transactional analysis, this is what we will explore. We as teachers will become aware of our ego states. We will understand what hungers drive us, what kind of hungers that make us do what we want to do. What strokes we give to the students? Do we appreciate them? Do we not appreciate them? Are we very negative or positive vis-a-vis the strokes we give to our students? Whether we are okay with ourselves. Very important. When we walk into a classroom, are we feeling that I am okay? That means I know what I am doing. I am okay with myself. I am allowing myself to make certain mistakes if I make the mistakes because I am human. Or I walk into the classroom thinking, oh God, I'm not good enough and these students are too smart for me and therefore, you know, I'll be a failure. Or the next point, whether we play games with people. Do we bring in our childhood experience and bring that to the classroom and play games with people? And finally, what is there in it is that to use this knowledge to be an effective teacher in the class, to handle our students' behavior in a mindful way. Keep in mind, the word mindful is very important. I don't want to be extremely, judgmental in the classroom, nor do I want to be so soft that my teachers walk all over me. So therefore, how do I handle my students' behavior in a mindful way? This is what is there for us as teachers in this session. We'll go with and we'll start with the first one. The first aspect or the first concept that Byrne brings in for any social transaction, any human transaction, and the human being itself, the psychology of human transaction, and that is ego states. What is this ego states? What is it that these ego states are, and what do they do to all the transactions that we make? Very simple if you look at it. All human beings and all of us come with a three-stage ego stages. These ego states, as Byrne calls them, is the parent ego state, the adult ego state, and the child ego state. What happens with the parent ego state? You know, basically, the parent ego state is a behavior that tells or that talks about being organized. It is copied from our parents. You know, for example, my parent ego state would have, you know, samples and would have triggers, examples of my parents' behavior. So if, for example, let us talk about myself, my parent figure. When I say parents' behavior, it could be any parent figure. So in my case, my parent figures were my grandmother also, along with my parents. And there are a lot of my behavior that I expect of myself and people around me comes from my parent ego state. And this parent ego state talks about being structured, about what is right, what is wrong. So do this, don't do this. this is acceptable, this is not acceptable. For example, being playful is not acceptable. Being weak is not acceptable. It's something that I carry with me. And in my adult ego state, I have worked on that. I have tried to understand that and bring in being playful, especially into my social interaction. The second ego state is the child ego state. Let's look at it. What happens in the child's ego state? It is basically feelings and behavior which is replayed from the childhood. So, if as a child I have been repressed, I have been, you know, suppressed, my emotions, my actions were suppressed, I will bring that and become extremely adaptive. I will become very compliant. I will be quiet. I'll become passive. At the same time, because I am passive and I also have the need to bring about these feelings, I'll become rebellious. So this is a child ego state, play with the child feelings. And then the middle one, which is a balance, is the adult ego state. The adult ego state is basically the here and now behavior. I look at actions that happens here that I am experiencing in my adult ego state as an adult, as a rational thinking adult, and then I respond to it as an adult without allowing my parent ego state or my child ego state to interfere and, you know, to break this transaction. So this is what ego states mean basically. It's a consistent pattern of behavior. So we use our ego states and it comes out consistently in a pattern of behavior. For example, when I was doing my transactional analysis, I sat with a group of students, my peers, and we did a quick analysis of each other. How do we experience each other? And believe me, I was surprised because I thought that I had brought in a lot of my child ego state to the classroom. My peers said that my parent ego state was there. Often I was critical or I was extremely protective. So, it's a consistent pattern and it comes in, it seeps in without us realizing, very much like a damp seeping into the walls of, you know, our rooms, especially if we have not curated it. And therefore, this is what the ego states. And you look at it. For example, if you look at this picture very interestingly, the parental ego state always says, do as I say. Do we bring this in the classroom? Do as I say. Keep quiet. Do not talk. Answer my questions. Your answer should be exactly a replica of what I have said. Well, we do that, right? So this is the parent ego state. However, the parent ego state also has other aspects that we will explore further. Look at the child ego state. The student may be vulnerable, may become open to you and bring in and say, what shall I do? I'm not able to do this. I don't know how to deal with it. I need your, you know, support. I need your ideas, your help. The child, therefore, or the student is actually opening up. And keep in mind, your students are, you know, very young kids. But that does not automatically mean that they are always in their child ego states. Even as young kids, we have these three ego states pretty alive and active in us. So if you look at this, every individual, be it an adult or a child, has these three aspects building very strongly within us. Now, what you see in front of you is a slide. Look at it very carefully and you will find that I have put across all the three ego states in these three circles. The first circle, which is the parent ego state, has two aspects. So, it does not necessarily mean that the parent ego state manifests in a behavior which is always critical. No. It has a positive, it has a negative aspect. There can be a very nurturing parent ego state, you know, taking care of people's requirement, protecting them, giving them enough time to work on it, their, you know, difficulties or their weaknesses. There can be a critical side of it, which says that, you know, you are not good enough. Do what I say. You better follow a structure. You follow the line. You toe my line. You must have heard teachers say, you know, my way or the highway, possible as a critical parent. Let us say, exercise with some of my students. I gave them a piece of paper and the paper had a dot. And I asked them to look at that piece of paper and write a quick essay of or a quick five sentences about that. And you would be surprised to know that 98% of my students started writing only about that black dot on the paper. None of them wrote about that so much of white space that was there in the paper. Why is that so? Because our critical parent is so high, we look at the negative, we look at finding the fault first, and we don't look at the positive aspect. So this is your critical parent. And of course, the adult, all of us are aware of it. Let's look at what happens in the child part, because this is what you will be dealing with a lot in your classroom. You know, you have a free child, a child that is free, spontaneous, creative, and does not fear to express what he or she feels. At the same time, you will have this particular student in the class who does not respond to you, who does not answer your questions. Or if you are trying to give them some guidance, these students will not even make eye contact with you. They will keep looking at the desk and they will pout, or they will mutter, or they will look extremely red in the face, the rebellious child that you have. At the same time, you also have this extremely adapted child, you know, the good student, the good child, the teacher's pet, who listens to everything you say, you know, who always says yes to whatever you say, and it's very easy for us to deal with these children, because we don't need to exert ourselves. So these are the different manifestations of the ego states and how they work in the classroom. Okay, so let me also then look at what happens in the controlling aspect or the critical parent aspect. You know, it's very important, because children require a structure, especially in a classroom. There is need for a structure. One needs to understand that there are some rules and one has to follow them. However, if the teacher becomes extremely punitive, and when I say punitive, what I mean is the teacher becomes punishing. So if you don't follow a structure, I will punish you. I'll throw you out of my class. I will, you know, scold you in front of everyone. Then the teacher becomes extremely negative in the critical parent aspect, and so on. So let's look at what happens in this parent, adult, and child ego state. Each of these has various expressions that they bring in. Each of these has certain body language that it is accompanied with. So as a critical or as a parent, the parent ego state, statements like "this is how you should do it, under no circumstances can you change it," or "don't lie to me, don't cheat," so, you know, statements like that with a finger pointing, patronizing gestures, which many of us do without realizing. However, as a child, or if you bring in the child ego state, what happens is children, if they are, you know, being playful, or if they are being rebellious, they have certain words or expressions that they use in the classroom. As you see in the slide, for example, you know, "I wonder," "please," and so on, or "I don't care," "I want to," and so on, is a manifestation of the child ego state. But what's important for you as teachers and for me as a teacher also, is that we bring in the adult ego state to the classroom, and therefore stay calm and composed and be open to our students. So for example, many teachers, you know, they say, "well, I walked into the classroom and there was a question that was asked. I didn't know the answer, and therefore what did I do? I told my student to shut up." Well, not required, because we are humans. Even as a teacher, we may or may not know everything, and it's not expected of us. So if I don't know, am I able to open up to my students, being in the adult, and tell them, "well, I don't know this, I'll research and come back to you with an answer." So this is how the ego states manifest in our behavior, how they are found in our actions, both verbal and non-verbal. And this is a very important aspect for you to mull over and think, which of these have you been demonstrating in your classroom vis-a-vis your students, and how has it impacted the various transactions you have made? At this point of time, you could, you know, before I start the next module, you could take a couple of minutes and actually jot down this in a blank sheet of paper, And when you go back to your e-lesson, you can compare it and tally it to see what kind of behavior you have been demonstrating and which ego state do you predominantly use in the classroom.